welcome to Hemeter Fieldhouse for tonight's game at 5 o'clock between the Punahou Buff and Blue and the Iolani Raiders. They're being introduced right now, the Iolani girls, starting five with Kylie Maeda, Sapphire Rosentis, Lahela Usui, Alex Masakel, and Taimane Pasi. Looks like we've got some underclassmen, one senior, two juniors, and two sophomores. And now for Punahou's lineup. They look ready to go tonight. Senior Julia Brand. Senior Haley Maeda.
At guard, 5'7" sophomore, number 20, Turner Wong.
Sophomore Turner Wong.
At guard, 5'9" junior, number 23, Misha Savaraka.
Junior Misha Savaraka.
And at guard, 5'8" senior, number 33, Jennifer Chin.
Senior Jennifer Chin.
Buff and Blue is Mike Taylor.
And of course, coaches are being introduced. Head coach Mike Taylor, assistants Alan Ching, Arvin Fujii, Liz Cam, Kevin Velasco, and assistant coaches for Iolani Raiders, head coach Eddie Maruyama, assistant coaches Rodney Veery and Glenn Young. So we're getting ready to start the game off. Players are getting onto the court soon. Looks like we'll have a pretty good match here. Lots of expectations from both teams, good rivalry. These girls know each other really well. They played against each other for many years in the ILH League as well as outside, and several of them are teammates on outside league teams. So here we go with the tip-off, Julia Brand and Alex Masakel. And Iolani's got the ball. And here is...
And I am here. Shelly, thanks for having me. Hi, I'm Mike Machado. We got Kali Maeda. She swings it out to Masakel. Back up top to Passy. Looking inside to Usui. She tries a layup. Falls just short. Turner Wong bringing it up. Jennifer Ching. Up top to Turner Wong. She tries from just outside of 15 feet. Bounces out. Official calls a jump ball.
Alex getting in there strong for that rebound coming from the outside. Looked like Punahou had a good position, but couldn't hang on to the ball.
Nope. Punahou keeps possession. Ching to inbound. Side to Wong. Cross court to Ching. She wide open jumps. She drains it.
That was beautiful.
That was some great ball movement.
That was nice.
Some really nice ball movement there. Yeah. Punahou applying some light pressure. Maeda breaks it. Looks like she's attempting a shot. Rebound.
Girls are doing a pretty good job of blocking out down there. Just couldn't get the ball.
Maeda looking for space. Punahou doing a great job with their zone here. As Brand with the rebound, looking for an outlet. Wong looking for Ching, thinking about a three-point shot. Brand up top. Side to Sadaraka. Ching. Iolani's in a, looks like they're in a 2-3. Inside to Brand, they find some space. She tries to lay it up. Comes up a little hard.
Nice spacing on that offense.
Yeah. Usui comes out with the rebound, Maeda. Side to Masakel. Back up top to Patsy. Maeda, looking inside to Masakel, no such luck. Resents with the drive, that bounces around and out. Sadaraka, Wong, outside to Ching, she's thinking about it, to Brand. Nice ball movement by the Buff and Blue. Sadaraka tries it from three. Oh. Great rebound from Maeda.
Great put back. Just coming back today after being out one game with an ankle injury, so it's really great to see her being able to get off the floor there.
That was a nice steal from Turner Wong. She tries the layup. She misses. Sadaraka with the rebound, and she's fouled.
It's great to see Turner Wong, a sophomore, filling in here and getting a good start in the game.
Pono seems like they're coming out with a real strong effort today. I think that loss against Midpack a few days ago might have lit a fire under them.
It sure did. I heard, talking to Mike Taylor, they had a great practice yesterday, which they didn't have on Monday. So I think the girls are feeling good about their preparation for today's game.
Feeling a little more focused?
Yes.
Yes. All right. Sadaraka hits both. Punahou out to a 6-0 lead here in the early stages of the first quarter. Still applying some token pressure. No shot clock in high school, so there's a... Punahou kicks the ball, will reset. Iolani going with a pretty young lineup. They have two sophomores, two juniors, and one senior starting. So not a ton of experience on this lineup. Maeda thinking about a shot.
Caught off guard there. 32 in the lane, too long.
About 3 seconds. Oh, wholesale substitutions for the Red Raiders. Coach Eddie Maruyama evidently, understandably, not real happy with what he's seen so far.
Right. And talking to him earlier, he really wants to put some pressure out here, and so they're going to be scrambling, and somebody's not getting it done, he's going to bring a fresh crew in.
That's what coaches do. But, yeah, I think if Punahou had come out flat in this game, you would have wondered what they didn't do at practice yesterday after that
right.
loss with the loss against Midpack.
Well, that's what quality teams do and programs
right.
do, is they sure make a lot of adjustments, especially after a loss such as that against Midpack. Of course, you can't take anything away from Midpack. They had a great game.
Came to play. Maeda is fouled down low. They have an Iolani personal foul on Lahela Usui. That's going to be her... No? Who did
first?
You call that foul on? No, that was...
Aubriana?
That was on Aubriana. I misread that. My apologies. Iolani's second team foul. Maeda misses her first of two shots. And evidently Coach Maruyama got his point across in the last 30 seconds. And we'll see what happens. Maeda shooting her second of two. Passy with the rebound, Maeda bringing it back up for the Raiders. Iolani running a lot of picks, trying to get Sapphire Resents the ball. She finds Massaquel down low. She's fouled.
Got our heads turned a little bit and didn't see that player under the basket.
That's going to be a Punahou foul on Haleyann Maeda, her first and Punahou's first team foul. We're going to have Alex Massaquel at the line shooting two.
Yeah, Haley's looking pretty good in this game so far. Coming back from an injury, sometimes you're pretty hesitant, and she's looking pretty confident out there.
All the Buff and Blue players really look like they're putting forth a good effort today.
Mm-hmm.
And she misses her second. Looking to Jennifer Wong looking for the long ball. Pass not quite enough energy behind it. Getting trapped in the corner. Maeda getting trapped. Back up top to Misha Sadaraka for three. It bounces around. Maeda with threatened rebound, trying to put back, and she's going to be fouled. That's going to be on Iolani's Taimani Posse, her first personal. Iolani's third team foul, and Maeda's going to the line again.
Nice. I mean, that seems to be what was missing in that game against Midpack, the rebounding that she's doing, just following up on the shots.
Exactly. She hits her first. I was talking to assistant coach Alan Ching before the game, kind of doing a postmortem on that Midpack game. He says, we didn't have our inside presence. I mean, a lot of balls that she normally picks off the boards and will get putbacks on. I mean, we're missing a few boards and 10 points a game, and there's your difference right there.
Right.
And she hits the second. So, she's back, and hopefully she's healthy. And we're already seeing her presence, and she's getting fouled a lot down low. That's going to be a Punahou foul, I believe, on Jennifer Wong. Her first Buff's second team foul.
Good intensity, just a little miscue on the footing there.
Mm-hmm.
Good pressure.
But you're seeing the effort, which is good. It's not clumsy. There's Ching kicking the ball again. I think that's the second time. Maeda looking to inbound. She finds Massacol down low. Maeda applies pressure, and she gets the bucket and the foul.
Just watching that movement on the ELNE team, there's definitely...
running a lot of motion.
A lot of movement, distraction.
Mm-hmm.
Not in the right place. I guess we can sometimes assume that there's a ball that's gonna, they're going to be looking for, the
right.
Opposite low post, which is often where it goes.
Right, I wouldn't be surprised if we saw Haley Maeda subbed out right now. She's got two quick fouls here. Oh. That was Jennifer Ching looking for Maeda down low. Iolani foul on Lahala Usui. That will be her second and Iolani's fourth team foul. And Maeda checks out for the Buffs. Michelle Park checking in for Punahou. Julia Brand, couple tries down low. She meets the rim. Misha Sadaraka, nice turnaround. Punahou up 10-3. About 5 minutes into the first quarter here. Punahou applying not terribly hard pressure, and Iolani seems to be having trouble negotiating it. Sadaraka going baseline, tried a little reverse action.
There's so many Punahou girls there. They're just assuming that the other one's going to get it also, so. Almost an easy conversion, but a little miscues, but nice.
Right.
Play by Misha, getting that tip, mm-hmm. creating that turnover, and now she's on the line.
Right. That was Alex Massaquil's first foul for the, her first personal foul. It's a Raiders 15th foul. Checking in for Punahou is Turner Wong replacing Jennifer Ching. We have Sadaraka at the line shooting her second of two. The pressure doesn't seem so stifling, but Iolani seems like they're having some trouble negotiating it. There's Park intercepts the pass, oh, and that's ripped again. Stolen back by Julia Brand. She's looking to go to the basket. Slips and travels. Yeah, tough luck for Julia Brand. I think she was looking a little far ahead on that.
She was anxious. Just for a nice play, and
mm-hmm.
Happens a lot. She plays so hard,
mm-hmm.
being a trackster, she has such speed and endurance, and also strength. Being a hurdler, you've got to be
mm-hmm.
really strong in those legs that oftentimes you're assuming
mm-hmm.
that you can do a lot more.
Right. As Park came down with the rebound. That's going to be an Iolani foul called on Alex Massacol, her second, and the Raiders' sixth team foul.
Julia Brand's getting a nice little break here. Nice substitutions here, give people a little rest.
Iolani's starting to apply some pressure now. Punahou breaks it. Dana Mao holds on. Wong. I've talked to Jennifer Wong now. Park. Sadaraka thinking about the three. Park drains it from eight. Nice look. Nice
getting
look.
Some scoring from the bench. Awesome.
14-3. They're with a little under 2 minutes here in, remaining here in the first quarter. Iolani does a nice job of breaking that press, and Taimani Posse puts it in for the Raiders. Still a 9-point difference here. Iolani trying to run some version of a trap here.
Puno's being very patient, looking for their openings, spreading out the offense. And a
nice pass from Michelle Park to a cutting Misha Sadaraka.
Nice cut to the basket, really opened things up.
kind of the live by the sword, die by the sword of the trap. Once you beat the trap, you know, you're potentially looking at 3-2 on the other half of the court. That's Maeda, a nice left-hander high off the glass.
So that's what Yuleni's doing, is they're just taking it to the hoop. You know, they're not waiting, just going right to it.
Turner Wong up top to Jennifer Wong. Sadaraka looking very comfortable on the wing. Here's side to Turner Wong. Ball's ripped by Alyssa Lee. And the Raiders turn it right back over. More wholesale changes for the Raiders. And checking in for the Buff and Blue, Arena Furuya. And checking back in is Jennifer Ching and Julia Brand also checking back in.
Got a lot of guards out there. We're going to be running. And there you go.
I think Coach Maruyama is going to start applying some pressure here. I mean, it's the only option I think he has. Ching looking for Park under the basket, calling a down official, calls a jump ball in possession to Iolani. All stolen by Jennifer Ching. She goes to the basket, tries to lay it off the glass, falls back. She gets her own rebound. Brand gets a rebound, puts it back up. No,
Nisha.
Another rebound. Oops, excuse me, Nisha Sadaraka, my apologies. A lot of good effort inside for the Buff and Blue. That's gonna be the first personal call on Quinnipiac's Jennifer Ching. The fourth team foul for the Buff and Blue. And at the end of the first quarter, our score, Quinnipiac 16, Iolani 7.
Nice start for the Buff and Blue. It's great to see them come out with that intensity and following through on their shots. It's great pressure up front, being able to deny a lot of the passes that are going across from left to right. It's great to see.
I mean, if you're Coach Mike Taylor at this point, yeah, we're up by 9. But, you know, what's he going to tell them at this point to keep them motivated?
I think he's trying to run everybody through and try to fit everyone into their offense. There's a lot of little hesitancy sometimes. They're doing a great job in spreading their press offense. Sometimes we get caught on that, mm-hmm. and we're throwing the ball away. We get a little rushed. We need to be a little bit more patient. So I'm thinking that we just need to fine-tune the things that are working really well for us. Get some of the shots off. Sometimes we don't need to rush into. Whenever we get a turnover, there's a tendency to want to just go to the basket rather than just running the play.
Sometimes
it's,
you know, as we saw Jennifer Ching do when she got called on that.
Right.
No, it was Julia. It was Julia with the traveling call on that far side. She seemed a little too eager to just go to the hole and slipped and shuffled her feet.
Right.
And got their turnover and got, you know, and gave a turnover. But as you were saying, probably more judicious to just kind of pull it out and set
right.
your offense and not give the ball up again.
Yeah.
But let's see, second quarter underway. A respectable crowd here at Pemeter Fieldhouse. I've seen larger.
Nice crowd for a 5 o'clock afternoon.
For a 5 o'clock game on a weekday.
Especially if they know it's being live streamed.
Week before Christmas.
Aye.
Yes. So the kids can do their homework and watch the game
and
at the same time.
Correct. And of course, we've got the boys varsity one basketball team watching. They've got a game right after this at 6:30.
Against Damien, I believe.
Against Damien, yes.
That game will not be webcast, but we will have another boys webcast later on in the season in January, I believe. So keep your eyes peeled for that. But Maeda looking down low for Passi. She tries to muscle around Brand. Brand pulls down the rebound. Furuya is fouled. Whoa, wait a minute.
They called a traveling on
her. She called a travel on that.
Sometimes we get a little, we take advantage defensively on that play.
Right. So Turner Wong checks back in, replacing Furuya. Nisha Sadaraka intercepts the inbound pass. She's looking to go to the basket. Left-hand layup off the glass, but no. Bahela Usui comes down with the rebound, and she is fouled by Julia Brand, her first. Buffs' fifth team foul.
You've got to have a lot of athleticism to be able to steal that ball. I mean, you know that there's going to be contact somewhere along the way. Referees could call that contact if somebody goes down on either player. So Misha doing a great job of being under control. Shows a lot of athleticism there.
She seems real comfortable on the floor.
Very.
There's a confidence there that she thinks about the three. Julia Brand waving her arms. She thought she had some space. All right.
Ilani just putting enough pressure that ball handler can't see that.
Right. Just enough. Sadaraka pulls up from 14. That bounces around. When Julia Brand went up for it, looks like she might have got poked in the face. Kylie Maeda bringing it up for the Raiders. Sapphire Resende is looking to go to the hole. She stops, pops.
You should have got up nice and high there, tipping that ball out of bounds. But again, effort to go after that ball. So we see the Punahou alumni band setting up there.
The Oahu, the Oahu College Band?
Correct.
Okay. 30-second timeout, I believe, called by, I think it was called by Iolani. But, it's nice to see all, there they are, the Oahu College Alumni Band. Nice to see all generations getting involved here.
Right.
I shouldn't laugh. I'm not so far removed from some of those generations. But
neither of us. And, of course, they're dressed in their gear, their holiday spirit, decorative headgear.
They're sporting, sporting Santa hats and elf hats and bells and antlers and... It's a real life high school event if you got a band.
That's right.
All right, and we're back to action. Maeda trying to inbound it under the basket. Jennifer Ching not giving her much of a chance. Maeda tries to bounce it off of Ching. Sadaraka steals it. Brand to her right. Brand going up. She's looking for a bank. Didn't get it. Gets her own rebound, but no. Park with the rebound. She stops from 12. That bounces in and out. Tough luck. Julia Brand again, and no. Resentes comes down with the rebound, and I think they're going to call Sadaraka with her first personal foul.
Sometimes just being in that vicinity, referees look for some contact.
You've had enough. You know there's been bump into that point, and it's like, okay, I should probably call something at this point,
even if
it wasn't so egregious, you know.
Yes.
I mean, I do have the whistle in my hand. Oh, Sadaraka with the steal gets it back to Brand. Ching.
She did a really smart thing in passing it out to her teammate behind her.
Very heady. Michelle Park down low. She banks it up and in.
Great left-hand shot. Things that are taught to these players from day one. So
right.
Another reinforcement.
Zent's looking to go all the way. Michelle Park puts a body on her, and she goes down.
Sapphire's been playing really hard. She's been driving to the basket, getting some shots off. They haven't really been falling for her, but working really hard and putting a lot of pressure offensively on Punahou team.
Yeah, they're trying to run a lot of picks for her. I see her running a lot of motion. She's just not getting the ball. Interesting to see now Julia Brand getting a spell and Haley Maeda checking back in. And Iolani coach Eddie Maruyama continuing with the platoon system here.
Right, you know, early in the season, you want to get a lot of your players in, giving them some time, game time, knowing that there'll be some playoffs down the road, and, you know, you really want to gain that experience, and it's a really key factor down the road.
Yeah, you know, and sometimes if you have a team that isn't so experienced, I mean, it's kind of really nothing lost. You're probably not expecting to win the majority of your games. You're still going to be competitive, but in the process, if you can still give your younger, you know, your whole team, sophomores and juniors, you know, why not spread out the playing time if nobody's asserting themselves?
Right. It means that your leadership has a much bigger picture, a much more, their goals are towards the ending of the season. So I think when you have a big picture like that, you make decisions that are important for the team in the long run.
Oh. Ebriana Johnson-Edwards, going straight to the basket for Iolani. Puniho playing the Matador defense there. Just letting her run right by. Sadaraka manages to get out of trouble.
That was always back almost out like Maeda. A scrum.
Yeah, there were three of them and one of her, and she found Maeda on the outside by the Ching. Cross court to Sadaraka, thinking about the three. Drives inside from just inside the free throw line. She misses. Katie Tom for Iolani. Johnson Edwards from a few feet outside the three-point line. Maeda collects the rebound.
She did a great job of not flicking it out there.
Hands it
amongst the red jerseys.
Jennifer Wong tries for a three, and that's no good. Katie Tom, they had numbers briefly there. So looking inside for Elisa Li'i'i, that ball goes out. And checking back in for Puniho are Turner Wong and Julia Brand. No, not putting up a whole lot of points here. We're halfway through the second quarter, and not a whole lot of action so far.
No. Offensive foul.
That's a rough call. What do you call that? I called that on Haley Maeda. That's her third.
Yeah, Alyssa getting a foul. really good position there, right. At least in the referee's eyes.
Right, and of course, yes. Of course, with her third foul, I don't expect to see Haley Maeda back on the floor anytime before the start of the second half. Jennifer Ching looking for somebody. She finds Jennifer Wong. Jaleen Wong applying pressure for the Raiders. And Coach Mike Taylor calls a 30 for the Buff and Blue.
It's nice to see some of these girls who are played together. On outside league teams here playing against each other again from different schools, but just means that girls basketball is just expanding. They're working hard to improve themselves and getting some game time in the outside leagues, traveling to mainland tournaments. Just fun to watch them come back here to the ILH League and play against each other.
Well, I mean, that's kind of the nature of high school sports. So you get to see these kids that have played together since they were 5, 6, 7 years old. And then they grow up out of their neighborhoods. And, you know, Hawaii is so loaded with private schools. I mean, it's not a neighborhood thing, you know, it's not always a neighborhood thing. And you don't always go to school with the kid you grew up next door to.
Right.
That you may have played community ball with.
It does provide for a lot more sportsmanship. And that's a great thing to see because it
yes.
does really
yes.
mean honoring the game, just wanting
yes.
each other to succeed.
Chin with the steal. She lights it out front for Julia Brand. She had eyes there, but she's fouled, and she'll be shooting, too.
There's that 400 sprinter's stride.
Yes. That's a strong runner. That's be an Iolani foul on Katie Tom, her first. And the seventh team foul for the Raiders, and Brand will shoot, too. Yeah, intermediate hurdlers and quarter milers, they're strong runners. I mean, they have inklings of, they have the edge of sprinter speed, but they're not quite the real speedsters, but they're strong runners.
Very strong
runners.
And can run forever.
Forever, yes. So endurance, not going to be a problem for Julia Brand.
Not a problem,
game.
Especially just coming off of the cross-country season.
She's running cross, of course, yes. of course. I was going to say, a lot of... A lot of hurdlers, a lot of soccer players too. You see a lot of cross-country runners, a lot of
Great.
Trade-off there. So Resent's top of the key.
A little mismatch down out. Low, haven't found her yet. Got Dana Mao on.
Taimani Passi.
Yeah.
Who's that? I think Resent's got that in. Iolani applying some more than a little token pressure here. Turner Wong. Big Puniho has numbers. From the baseline, she stops, pops, no good. Maeda. Buff and Blue quick back on defense. Sadaraka matched up with Resentes up high. Maeda working off the pick. Three-pointer, finding a lot of air. Checking back in for Punahou is Jennifer Ching. And also checking back in is Michelle Park. Yeah, Park did nicely when she checked in the first quarter. It'll be nice to see her duplicate that here with Maeda sitting on the bench for the rest of the half. We'll call a jump ball and possession to Iolani.
Jen Huang struggling a little bit with the pressure. I think she's seeing some daylight, but Yelani's been doing a great job of closing her down.
Try to teach your guards never to pick up the dribble in the backcourt. Easier said than done.
Using that backwards dribble, backing up, just like in soccer.
Right. Sometimes retreating is an option. But, well, how about Usui from three, and that's no good. Ching has looking up. Looking for Julia Brand.
Lahela got up so high.
Yeah.
Which also means she's got to come down.
Exactly.
And that hurt a little bit. But wow, what a leap that she had and able to tip that ball from Julia's hands.
Julia was looking at a layup if she had that.
Correct.
All right, Misha Sadaraka down low. She bounces it off the glass and in.
Beautiful finish.
Punahou takes an 8-point lead with 2 minutes here left in the first half. Zent's looking to take Park on. She turns and picks up the foul. It'll be Park's second foul, Buffen Blue's ninth team foul. And Sapphire Resentes is going to the line, shooting two. Yes. She seems to have a motor, this one.
She sure does.
Nothing but net for the first one.
And a nice touch on her shot.
Michelle Park just picked up her second. She'll sit for the rest of the half probably as Dana Mao checks in. Zentes with her second. And she drains it. What was once a double-digit lead for the Buff and Blue is now a 6-point game. Jennifer Ching to Brand. She's looking for contact, tries to bounce it off the glass. No good. And it'll be Punahou's ball still.
Just shows that early passing into those gaps is working well for Punahou when they're able to see those passes and open up some shots.
And Brand has beaten a lot of people down the floor.
There you go. Played a little double dribble, a little bump.
Yep. Yeah, I thought I saw the double dribble too. But they call a Punahou foul on Turner Wong, her first. It's a 10th team foul for the Buff and Blue. So Iolani will be shooting two in the bonus.
Kylie Maeda is looking pretty good after coming off a knee injury.
Yes. Yes, she is. She drains the first one. And checking back in for the Buff and Blues, Jennifer Wong replacing Turner Wong. No good for Maeda. Mao with the rebound. Wong. She's stripped from behind. Maeda's bringing it back the other way. Punahou's back on defense. Maeda kicks it back out to Napier. And she banks it in.
One-legged shot.
And it's a 3-point game. This was a 9-point game at the quarter. They're calling Jennifer Ching for pushing off. That'll be her second personal. Punahou usually gets the benefit of the doubt on the calls here, and not today.
A nice rotation coming in for Iolani.
Is it, Does it make it tough to keep track of your matchups as a former coach when you see that when you do the platoon substitutions like this when other teams do that? Does it make it tougher for you to keep track of the matchups sometimes?
Your players really need to be attentive to that because that's where the breakdowns come. Mm-hmm. And you can tell those inexperienced teams losing their man oftentimes on those substitutions. So I think this experienced team here kind of knows that they will be spoken to if they are going to lose their man on the court.
Right. So Alex Massaquil went over the back, and that's going to be her third foul. A lot of fouls in this foul-heavy game, I think. They're calling her over the back. That's the eighth team foul on the Raiders. So one player on each team with three fouls in the first half already. That's
quite a bit. Does it affect the substitutions?
And these are both the post players for each team as well. It's Massaquil for Iolani and Haley Maeda for Punahou.
This means that Michelle Park's getting more time on the court, and she's been doing a pretty good job while she's been out there.
Been holding her own. Yeah. Been holding her own. We have Brand at the line shooting her second of two. And that's in, and it's a five-point lead again for the Buff and Blue. 37 seconds left here in the first half at Hemeter Fieldhouse. Brianna Johnson-Edwards bringing it up for the Raiders. She kicks it back out to Napier. See if they hold for the last shot here. Doesn't look like they're waiting for that. Mal with the steal. Puts it up.
We should be looking
Don't
for
pick
a
up
pass.
The dribble. Someone help. Brand in the middle. She sees Sadaraka to her right. She got the blocking foul. And she'll be shooting too, and that'll be an Iolani foul on Caitlin Shikana. That'll be her first personal. Raiders ninth team foul. Sadaraka's at the line shooting too.
She did a great job of pulling up rather than following through. She knows that they've been calling some offensive fouls, so good job in pulling up, taking that shot, making the defense play, position themselves well.
And with the way the officials are passing out fouls in this game, it'll be nice if Sadaraka of our players could go into the half with only one personal foul at this point.
So we got a new player in, meaning we get a little extra rest for Julia Brand.
With Stacy Lynn checking in. Ooh, almost. Caitlin Shikata tries to go high off the glass and no. So at the end of the first half, your score, Punahou Buff and Blue 23, Iolani Raiders 18. Well, that was a foul-laden second half, I think. Not a lot of points for the Buff and Blue there.
Yeah, we weren't able to get into a flow as well as we did in the first half. I'm not sure what they're going to be talking about in the halftime, but we've got so many people rotating in and out.
Right.
There's so many different things that each individual person can be working on.
Right, right. So it'll be interesting to see what, it's a tale of two quarters here. As, Punahou looked really nice, looked very competitive in the first half. I was kind of expecting them to pull away a little bit in the second quarter.
Yeah.
And it seemed like Iolani stepped up their pressure a little bit there in the second quarter. And
maybe those matchups caused
trouble with the matchups. But we're here with our halftime interview with our one of our Punahou facilities people, Mr. Scott Metcalf. Scott, thank you for joining us today.
Thank you. Get me away from the
wearing multiple hats today. So what'd you see in that first half? It was a tale of two quarters, huh?
Definitely a tale of two quarters. Punahou was taking it to them early on, and then Iolani come back in the second quarter, making it an interesting matchup.
Yeah, the pressure on, Punahou, it seemed like in the first quarter, Iolani was kind of applying some token pressure, and Iolani and Punahou was negotiating it, and then, seemed like the platooning seemed to kind of take its toll on Punahou, and
Yeah, from I'm a soccer player, volleyball player, but from watching all the basketball games, looks like they're Iolani's trying to slow it down. Puno likes to run. I'm not sure what your assessment has been, but you know, getting girls minutes and
right.
a good matchup.
Right. Because I mean, you know this. I mean, any coach knows. I mean, we were discussing this earlier that you know when you have a young team that doesn't really have a standout player, as it appears Iolani had. You know, you try to get playing time for your players, and I mean that's what he's doing. And it creates you know the matchup problems we saw here in the second quarter.
Iolani definitely going to make things interesting. Puno was losing the other night. They've got something to prove. Come back, get past that loss. They started out the gates real strong, but it's a different game right now.
So do you want to tell us a little bit about some of the events that are coming up during these next couple of weeks? I know we've got a tournament and we've got some other things coming up. You want to share some of that?
Yes, we've got the, I forget what annual, it's the mini annual, it's 30-something annual Puno Boys Basketball Tournament. Starting on Monday, December 20th, there'll be four games. Going on Monday, starting at 3 p.m., 4:30, 6, and 7:30 p.m. Likewise on Tuesday, the 21st, and then Wednesday, we've got a little something different going on. We're going to have the Constellation and earlier matchup starting at 9 a.m., 10:30, and noon, and they're moving the championship game to Stan Sheriff Center and going to play a 2 o'clock matchup at Stan Sheriff. It's kind of a pre-build-up for the Rainbow
Diamond Head Classic.
And actually, I think most of the boys from Puno Basketball Tournament will be getting tickets to go support the college game, which will be a good treat for our boys. Actually, all 18 will get tickets.
Great partnership with the University of Hawaii and allowing the tournament to expand there and include those high school players.
Right,
what a great partnership for our high school kids to be able to see that college level.
Yeah, this is all just developed in the past. I think they've been talking a couple months, but things came together really in the past week. I know Darren, the head coach for our boys program, is meeting with the Stan Sheriff officials today. We're still not sure some of the logistics, but they'll get ironed out before next week.
Together.
The finals. So,
what can you tell us about some other events, such as the alumni game?
The alumni games, I believe it's on December 31st. Traditionally, soccer, boys and girls soccer, have always had alumni games. So we're trying to make it Kiki Schaefer and the alumni group up in the alumni house is putting together. We've got a basketball tournament, we've got soccer games, and I believe there's going to be a water polo, some matchups. You can check the Punahou website under the alumni link and probably get some more information on how to sign up. Just show up that morning. We'd love to have you. I think they're giving out T-shirts if you're an alum while sizes last.
Right, right. So is this alumni on alumni or alumni on the active teams? Or is it on a sport-by-sport basis? Or
I believe, soccer, I know it's alumni versus our varsity teams.
Okay.
And that's what we've been doing for years. Basketball, I believe they're going to be making teams with who signs up. I don't know if they'll do it by whether you have co-ed teams or whether you do it by year. We'll see who shows up. And basically, it's a get-together, come back to Puno, visit campus, see what's going on, say hi to your friends, the college kids that are in town, hook up.
And they're doing it on New Year's Eve day, too. So what better way to come back on campus and meet up with some of your old buddies?
That is a holiday, but that's been tradition for the soccer program. And they're just basketball and water polo now tagging on.
So last year they had a great tournament amongst the alumni for basketball, and it seems it was a real success, and it's just expanding with the other sports coming together.
Kiki's doing a great job up at the alumni house, really connecting people together. Puno has been a great experience for most of us. Not all Puno students feel that way, but eventually, like Jim Scott said, they pay forward. A lot of kids are given a lot of opportunity here, and it's time to, if we can, give back. So.
Great.
Yeah, that's why I'm here.
Exactly.
I'm here. Thanks, Mike.
And you're here in a different role
today. I'm not wearing multiple hats today. So how many teams have they got for these basketball tournaments?
This is going to be a new one because they're bringing it all together on January 31st. So again, I think whoever shows up, it's sign up, and they create the teams right there on the spot.
Oh, wow.
They'll run short, sideways here in the gym. We can go three games. I guess they go half court if they start losing their lungs a little bit. So
really?
It'll be fun.
I imagine full court games could be a little rough on the alumni.
Well, we'll have some extra ice bags, I'm sure.
Okay, good. Admiral and S ice bags. All right.
Extra holiday bags.
Right, and it is New Year's Eve day, and you know I'm certain there'll probably be coolers of lots of ice lying around.
Ice water.
Yeah.
Okay, I've got to get back to the clock. We got the 3-minute buzzer. My assistant, Venus Lee, who's actually back from LA yesterday, she's up in the USC area doing my scorekeeping again. So appreciate talking to you and good job.
All right, well, thanks a lot for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
Thanks for stopping by,
bye-bye.
Scott.
All right, so we a few minutes left here in the halftime. Punahou taking a 5-point lead into the second half. And like we said, tale of two quarters there. Didn't seem like any team found a real rhythm at any point. I mean, even in the first quarter when Punahou was up by 9 or 12 points, it didn't seem like they were really establishing anything. There wasn't any flow or harmony.
No, and I think that's what the coach is going to be talking about, really trying to work through some of the offensive flow, looking for their options, setting better picks, their timing, trying to get the ball in low to their players. They've been doing a great job. We haven't been able to finish as well, but I'm sure that we're going to be coming back pretty strong. Iolani at the same time has really got so many players out there that are creating a lot of havoc, and they're all doing a really good job. So this should be interesting to see.
So you think we'll see more of the same from Iolani coming
definitely.
Out applying that press?
It's working for them. And, you know, I was talking to Coach Eddie, and, you know, like most teams, especially the Kamehamehas, Punahou, and Iolani, where there are so many teams practicing, it really is tough to get practice time in and to develop the skills for the players. The season's been shortened. There's so many, because there's boys and girls trying to practice in the gyms, there's less time. I know that Punahou has been struggling. It's been a huge challenge for them to work through the schedule of 13 teams all together.
Because at what point do more opportunities become less opportunities?
And that's how it seems right now, and that's always going to be the debate. You know, you always want as much participation as you can. At the same time, at what expense? So we'll see how it goes. I mean, everybody will have an opinion about it, and it really depends on the perspective. This is an educational institution, and we really want to serve as many students as we can. So it's something that everyone will have to be in a good discussion about. And talking to Coach Eddie about, you know, what time might they have the girls' season start, since volleyball gets done a little bit earlier than football might. Is there a scheduling strategy that they can use to allow for a little bit more quality time? They actually attempted to do that this time around. It was a intermediate started first, and then a week or two later, the JV started, and then the girls' varsity started, and the boys' varsity, of course, was the last one to begin, because they do finish up with the state tournament 2 weeks after the girls. So,
you know, and you wouldn't think, I mean, a school like Punahou that does have an abundance of space, you know, still having to have this debate. It's a nice debate to be able to,
yeah.
It's a nice question to have to answer, but in the same breath, you know, if it's not going to allow your teams to be competitive.
There was an abundance of space until we added the boys and the girls teams together. So.
And we are back.
Yeah.
And Turner Wong drains a long two.
Beautiful.
To open up the start of the third quarter. And a 2-on-1 for the Raiders. Resendez pulls up, turns, banks it, and it's in.
Good finish by Sapphire Resendez.
Yeah, and there you go. First instinct, she could have just taken that one straight up. She pulled back a little bit, turned, still got the shot off. Brand looking to bull her way in down low. Doesn't quite get to the rim. Bit of a scrum. Maeda breaks the pressure.
I do think we are forcing some of the shots down low.
That was a three. That's a 2-point game. Sadaraka getting some pressure. Back out top to Ching. And she travels. Iolani ball. Iolani with a basket could tie or take the lead for the first time since the opening tip.
Coach is trying not to panic here. We're not trying not to panic. We're just steady. I'm sure that they've got a plan, so something that we just got to stick with.
I was talking to assistant coach Alan Ching before the game, and he was saying, you know, one of the things that they, you know, one of the coaching points they'll learn after mid-pack is, you know, sometimes we're not always going to be ahead. We're going to have to learn how to play from behind sometimes, ladies. Yeah. That's, you know, that's part of the game. It's nice to think we're always going to be winning, but that's probably not going to be the case. Jennifer Ching tries to throw it up there, but no. Maeda comes down with a rebound. Near side to Usui. Wow,
that was a quick
one. Very quick jump ball call. Usui wondering, wait a minute. Yolani keeps the ball on this possession. Let's see, Kylie Maeda. Back into Alex Masukwell. Playing with three fouls. Maeda from three. And she drains it, and the Red Raiders take a one-point lead. Minute and 45 into the second half. Jennifer Ching going hard, and no. Masukwell with the rebound. Maeda pushing it. She's got numbers. Posse underneath. That bounces around, but no. Sadaraka controls the rebound. Pushes it up to Brand Ching. Brand not expecting the pass. He kicks it back out to Maeda.
Good timeout call. We're looking a little messy out there.
Exactly. Looking a little ragged.
Yep.
Looking a little ragged. I think it's one of those where he sees, let's just, okay, we're getting the ball. We're just not completing the sequence here. Let's stop. Right. Take a beat. Take a breath, ladies. You know, that's... Because as you've seen, we've, you know, pushed the ball up the last three times up the floor and came back with nothing when we've had numbers.
Yes. We seem a little anxious to get it in there. We get a little caught up, fumbled the ball. We're not getting some clean catches. When it's not clean in your hands, you can't make great shots and you can't make good passes. And then you're playing little, you know, Park
right.
League kind of ball.
Right. You see, and the... I mean, what I'm seeing is they're almost feeling a little bit of pressure. You know, we're only starting the second half, ladies. You know, it was a five-point game going into half. Iolani's up by one now. But still a long time left in this game. We don't need to press yet. And that's kind of what I'm seeing there. They're trying to force up shot. They have the shots, but you just see them a little tight and they're maybe rushing a little bit.
Yes, yes. And, you know, they really have a great press offense with the middle player coming through. They swing the ball to the right and the left sides very, very easily. They're very strong with the ball, so it shouldn't be a problem bringing the ball down the court.
No. That's why I'm kind of surprised. All right. Sadaraka. Back to Wong. She's looking for Brand. Brand trying to push. Swung back across to Sadaraka. She's got an open. That bounces around and in. For Misha Sadaraka, Pinaho back in front by one. Pinaho applying some nice pressure. I think we're going to see it. He's called jump balls for less.
That was really interesting.
I was waiting for the whistle about 2 seconds ago on that.
I think everyone was waiting for that.
Nothing but love for our men in the stripes.
That's right.
Nothing but love.
Thankless job.
Thankless job.
We are just grateful that they're here. You know,
exactly.
Some games we haven't had referees, so we're just grateful they're here.
I know one of them, I was talking to one of them before the match who I happen to have known since we were classmates in kindergarten. And he says he makes time for this. He's been doing this for 17 years. Julia Brand tries to layup and no. But he says, yeah, I got the cushy federal job, but you know what? I make time to come and do this. I know, but I love it. So, you know, more power to him.
Right.
But anyway. For three, couldn't see who took that. That was Kana trying to three. Sadaraka with the rebound. Brown back to Sadaraka.
Okay.
She's got to advance it. Oh, Jennifer Ching kicks it out to Maeda. Not finding a range there.
I'm not sure that was a great shot selection there, but.
Probably not for her.
No, there was a lot of space out there. Iolani's coming out wide. They're picking up. They're spreading it a little bit, and no one was cutting to the basket. There was no post in there to move the ball around. So
Yeah, she probably could have dribbled that once or twice and shortened the range a little bit. And you're probably not going to see her taking many shots outside of 10 feet.
Yeah. We haven't seen them run their offense as well as they did in the first few minutes of the game.
No.
We haven't seen that in a while.
Right. All right, some token pressure being applied by Johnson Edwards on Sadaraka. The wing to Long, back to Sadaraka. Ching, top of the key, she turns. Side to Mao, she jumped. Nope. Fast break to Taimani Posse. Oh, that's Alex Massaquel out in front of everyone with the layup and in. Iolani takes the lead again, 28-27. Sadaraka thinking about, you know, she had that one three-point shot earlier in the game, and you know she's itching to do that again. All right. Sadaraka, right hand, stops, pops. Off the front of the rim, Wong with the rebound. Back to Sadaraka. We're calling Sadaraka for pushing off.
A little frustration. I mean, she's having a...
I was seeing a lot of frustration right now.
Ibrianna's doing a really good job on putting pressure out there. You know, she's a young player, but she's got a lot of, she's got a great shot. Just listening to Coach Mike Taylor talking about her, she's got lots of potential coming out the next couple of years. So.
Mm-hmm.
Nice.
Turner Wong with a steal. Oh, and she gets hacked on the way up. She'll be going to the line, and that's going to be a foul on Wahela Usui. I believe that is her second or third. That is her third personal foul.
Watching Turner Wong play as a youngster, really seen her grow a lot, but she's always been that tenacious player, so not really surprising. She's being able to pick those point guards and get a few steals for the Buff and Blue. She's done that a few times. Pretty unassuming for some. It's nice to see that. Now she gets to convert on her free throws here. Hopefully she can finish with this second one.
And just off the left side of the rim. And almost, oh. Wong almost gets the rebound, and it's going to be Buff and Blue ball. All right. We got a tie game, all 28, 3 minutes left in the third quarter. Jennifer Ching inbounding the ball in front of her own bench, side to Michelle Park. Back to Park inside, stolen by Napier. She may have been better suited to pull that one back, but Resents gets the rebound, loose ball. She steps on the line, it'll be Punahou ball. I think Napier just saw the basket and was going.
Yep. the pressure that they're putting on Punahou right now is creating some havoc for them, just like that.
Like right there. Another turnover. Think. I mean, we have capable ball handlers. It's not.
Yes.
We have Johnson Edwards back outside to Resentes for three. Sapphire Resentes for three for Iolani. And the Red Raiders take a 3-point lead here with just over 2 minutes remaining in the third quarter. Jennifer Ching is fouled. Iolani's Abriana Johnson Edwards, her second, Raiders' second team foul. Checking back into the game for Punahou is number 21 at Caitlin Walkie.
Caitlin, a freshman, coming in to take that point.
All right, here's your chance to make a name for your son. young woman. It's the basket for the Buff and Blue. Back to a 1-point game, so you know, kind of trial by fire here for our freshman. All stolen by Turner Wong. Jennifer Ching picks it up. She looks for Joaquin and she lays it in. Quinnahoe back in the lead. Iolani trying to push the action back up the other way. Resents, pulls up, and she drains it. Suddenly got some action here in the end of the third quarter.
Beautiful finish. I mean, she just brought that ball down three quarters of the way and was able to pull that shot up and make it.
And that'll be Sapphire Resent's first personal foul and her third team foul for the Raiders. More wholesale changes. Misha Sadaraka checking back in for the Buff and Blue, replacing Jennifer Ching.
The strategy by Iolani is working really well for them, just platooning, putting a lot of pressure on them, knowing that they can do that with all of the players they have on the court.
That's Turner Wong for a long two. A long two, I think her foot was on the line. Maeda for three, bounces out Sadaraka, picks it up. She's pushing it.
Does she get two?
I think they're giving her the shot on that. And that, I think that's gonna be foul number four, possibly, on Lahela Usui. Raiders' fourth team foul, and Sadaraka's at the line shooting two.
This is one of those situations where you've got a one of your talented players want to take some leadership on the court, and knowing that her place out there is really going to make a difference for her team. So just taking it straight to the hoop. I think Yelena gave her a little space there.
Mm-hmm. Passy comes down with a rebound on the second free throw. 1 point game, under a minute in the third quarter. Massaquel throws it up. Loose ball, another scrum. We got another jump ball, who knew? Right possession going to the Red Raiders.
As the coaches say, get down on that floor and go after
Hit
it.
Hit the floor.
Yeah,
it's gonna hurt, but it'll hurt less if you come up with the ball, let me tell
right.
you.
Right.
Right, Stacy Lynn checking in for the Buff and Blue the last 40 seconds. The third quarter, and what has become very tightly contested game, Shelley. First quarter, sure. I was thinking Quinnahoe might just kind of walk away with this one, and they were up to a 12-point lead at one point.
You know, they know each other so well, and you can never take a team for granted.
And it's Quinnahoe Iolani.
Right.
Zenes gets into the key, shoots short jumper. Massaquel with the rebound. Passy with the rebound, and no good. Sadaraka carrying it up. She's beating everyone up the floor, looking for Park on the left. She tries, it bounces out, no good. Park with her rebound, she tries another shot, and that's no good.
This is exciting ball.
We're getting excited here in the third quarter. All right. We have Julia Brand and Haley Maeda checking back in for some inside presence. The waning moments of the third quarter. Sadaraka finds Wong up top. Back outside to Waukee. Bench calling out the time on the clock. Sadaraka trying the bank shot. That bounces around and that's no good, and we're right where we were not too long ago. 1 point game here at the end of three at Emmeter Fieldhouse. So,
whew.
Yeah, it's gotten competitive here in the third quarter now.
A lot of energy out there.
I'm getting tired looking at them.
Again, it would really be nice to see that Quinnahoe team really being patient on their offense, moving the ball around a little bit more. They're looking a little frazzled out there. Know that there's a lot of energy going, but.
Right, I wouldn't say they're losing their composure. I think you're right, frazzled is a good word. Yeah. I mean, you know, if they have a couple bad possessions and if Iolani gets out to a 3 or 4 point lead, I'll be curious to see if Quinnahoe starts to push a little more. But you're right, they are rushing things. They're getting the shots, they're just not, you know, they're getting decent looks, but they're just going up tight and they're not going in.
That's their game, to run, So you know that they're going to run at you also. But converting on those shots would be to their advantage. Here we've got the band playing for us.
And it's not like Iolani's running there, you know, doing anything spectacular with their offense either. They haven't really found any harmony. It's just one of those scrappy games, get on the floor, a lot of jump balls, a lot of fouls, a lot of contact.
A lot of transition game, trying to score off of that transition.
All right, and we're starting play here in the early stages of the final quarter between Iolani Red Raiders and York Punahou Buff and Blue. Nice drive by Aubriana Johnson-Edwards. They're calling a loose ball foul.
On Misha?
No, I think that may have been on Julia.
Yep.
Oh, it was on Misha. No? Misha Sadaraka with her third foul. Up and Blue's second team foul. Ida. Down low for Passi. She turns. Tries kind of a hook shot. Maeda comes down with the rebound. Sadaraka bringing it up. She's getting some pressure. She finds Jennifer Wong. And there's that Iolani playing that pressure again. And I think that was going to be another foul on Haley Might. That's going to be on Jennifer Wong, her second.
Trying to get out of the trap. Ball's taken away, trying to get it back.
You think our girls are getting tired?
No, I think they're getting caught. And they're
frustrated?
Not releasing that ball early enough and looking for that open player. You've got two players on you in a trap. Somebody's open. Just need to be able to find that player before that trap gets up in your face.
To find that pass about half a step sooner.
Right here.
Oh, here we go. We got one-on-one. Turner Wong pulls up, trying a high bank, but no. Julia Brand with the rebound. She tries to go high off the glass, and no. Tamani Passi comes down with the rebound, and Kyla Maeda. Bring it up down low to Caitlin Shikata. Go to Passi. She turns on Haley Maeda and banks it off the glass and in. Iolani takes a one-point lead. Iolani sticking with the pressure. As Jennifer Ching stops and pops from the free throw line. Haley Maeda with the rebound. She's fouled on the putback and she'll be going to the line.
Great positioning to get that rebound and trying to follow up with the shot. That really helps the Punahou team get possession back after the shot.
And that foul is going to be on Taimane Passi, her second. Haley Maeda at the line shooting two.
How was that, Aubriana catching up with her?
Yeah, that's an athlete.
Yes.
You know, most of the first quarter, Haley Maeda was at the free throw line so often. I think she was getting mail there, and I kind of expected that's how things were going to go. And she met with some foul trouble and spent a fair portion of the first half. She gets her own rebound and the putback and in. She gets one free throw and the field goal on the putback. So Punahou by two with a little over six remaining. There you see Lahela Usui driving right through, right around the Punahou defense and in for a tie game. Sadaraka, wide to Jennifer Ching. Maeda, unguarded inside the key. Mao with the rebound, back out to Maeda, Sadaraka. Jennifer Ching, her hand wrapped. She's got an injured thumb, I understand. Not a good thing when one of your primary ball handlers has a sprained thumb. Sadaraka out wide. And the official saying Aubriana Johnson-Edwards got all of that ball, and he's calling a jump ball.
I love to see that. I mean, sometimes we put our hands up just to put our hands up, but being able to put it up.
And the ball ends up there.
Right, and be tracking the ball when you do that is key. It really prevents passes to be made. It's very, very effective.
And I'm certain as a coach you like to see that. It's like, okay, something I'm telling them is registering because you don't always think it's going to. And that's a basket by Alex Masiquel and Iolani up by two.
Needing to look for some passing right here. We need to get the ball down the court rather than dribbling into these crowds. Cross-court pass doesn't quite make it.
And another turnover.
Yes.
Right, doesn't seem like they're just kind of spacing on the floor and they're accepting whoever's bringing the ball up. And, Wahela Usui has a three ball go in and out. Now they're suspecting Sada Rocker or Ching to bring the ball up the floor and run the offense from there. The other three players on the floor doesn't seem like they're given a whole lot of support.
No, they're not sure whether they're going to be driving it in, moving the ball around. Right now she's taking it to the hoop. And it counts.
Wow, he gave that count the basket. Personal foul called on Wahela Usui. Wait a minute, is that, no, check that. Who was that foul called on? No, Aubriana Johnson-Edwards is they're giving the foul to. That's her third and the sixth team foul. Sada Rocca converts the three-point play. I can understand Coach Eddie Mariama being a little upset about that one. That's,
Well, you've got to question that. You got to at least question it.
Yeah.
But, you know, there's so many other calls or no calls out there that are happening, so it doesn't really seem one-sided, although it may seem like that.
No, they're calling them both ways.
Right.
It's a Punahou foul on Julia Brand, only her second. Punahou's fourth team foul.
So you got a pretty big lineup here for Punahou, which is pretty nice having Haley back on the court again. It'd be nice to be able to see her stay on the court. Looks like she might get a little rest down the road, but hopefully she'll be able to finish the quarter off. They sure could use her out there.
Punahou on the floor with Haley Maeda, Misha Sadaraka, Julia Brand, Jennifer Ching, and Turner Wong. Masiquel sinks the free throw. Put the Red Raiders up by one. Here with 4:42 left in the game. Maeda almost throws that ball away. Sadaraka picks it up. She finds Turner Wong. Back to Brand cross court. Brand puts it up and she gets the foul.
Nice cross court pass made by Turner Wong. And being able to catch that pass, of course, is really important. Oftentimes, especially our younger girls, not as strong in being able to catch a forceful pass like that, but something that's really effective if you can use a cross-court pass.
And you're not always expecting it.
Correct.
You're not always expecting that pass. But Julia Brand beats everybody down the floor, so she's expecting the pass.
She's a solid player. Once she gets the ball, it's very hard to stop that shot from her. She's pretty solid. Nice finish on her free throws, too.
She sinks both of them to put Punahou back in front by one. Punahou staying with their big lineup. It's like Iolani's kind of settled on a lineup here as well. Almost looks like the first semblance of a half-court offense we've seen in some time.
Yes.
Out wide, Masiquel thinking about a three-point shot. Maeda pulls it back out. Sadaraka guarding the point. Masiquel. Usui going to the hoop and she gets fouled.
I don't think they were ready for that drive. You know, in that position, you would think that they'd look to draw a foul, but I don't think, or draw an offensive foul. I don't think that they were quite ready for that, so.
No.
They need to be able to anticipate what's going to be happening in this offense.
All right, and so Haley Maeda picks up her fourth foul, just under 4 minutes remaining. Wahela Usui also playing with four fouls. She misses her first of two. Sapphire Rosente is checking back in for the Raiders. Mike Taylor not wanting to see Haley Maeda foul out just yet. It's a little too much time to leave her in there with four fouls. And of course, Lahela Usui, as I said, also playing with four fouls for Iolani. And she ties it up. 42 all.
One, two, six players. All right.
There we go. Oh, give the ball. Julia Brand gives the ball away. Rosense is stripped by Sadaraka. Double teamed by Brand and Sadaraka. Ching comes up with it. It's for Brand. Brand drives baseline, lays it up and in for Julia Brand. That's what we should be able to do.
Yes.
In negotiating the press. We have the tools to do that. So, Johnson Edwards with the ball for Iolani. Out for Shikata. Left hand out wide, looking for Massaquel. Looking for that three ball and no good. Sadaraka carries it up the floor for Punahou. Almost stripped by Caitlin Shikata. Jennifer Ching holding. Punahou looking to run their offense here. Rosense giving pressure. Turner Wong into the key, back out to Wong. Sadaraka, ooh, I think she's wishing she pulled up on that.
Probably want to take an inside shot and not a three right now unless you're really, really confident about that.
It's Turner Wong. King Cross, throwing the ball away, another needless turnover. Looking for Jennifer Ching down in the corner. And we have Haley Maeda checking back into the game with under 2.5 minutes remaining.
A little groan in the crowd. It was really moving really well. But I think we're going to be getting it back. I know Turner's really thinking about that, and she's going to need to get that ball back and make up for that pass.
Neither team's had more than a 2-point lead here in the fourth quarter. It's been a 1-to-2-point game since about halfway through the third quarter. Posse holds the ball down low, and Punahou's defense gets the jump ball and possession it going to Iolani. The way these teams are playing so far, I think if either one of them gets out to a 4 or 5 point lead, that could be the game.
That's like a three point shot right there. That could really turn it, but who's going to take that?
Neither team scoring in spurts at this point. But we got a 30-second timeout called by Iolani. We'll see. Be interesting now that if the coaches make a point to become more deliberate with their offenses.
Definitely.
We'll see if they can, maybe pull the defenses back a little bit and become more deliberate with their play. I mean, what would, you're a former coach.
Catching the ball. Triple threats.
Right.
Looking towards the basket and not curling up so that the defense is able to double team you. You really have to move the ball, keep it away from the defense. Look for those gaps.
Uh-huh.
That's where the timing comes into play, and being able to, having played together for a while and knowing each other really helps in this situation because you can anticipate what your teammates are going to do.
All right, and we are back to play. Ching kicked ball.
So we got the guards flashing down low on this. We got caught in this position against mid-pack also. The guards coming down into that low post position and getting some easy baskets. So.
I think we have a question of possession here. Officials, Scott Metcalf working the possession arrow, trying to explain to the coaches Mike Taylor and Eddie Maruyama.
Just clarifying some of the
Kaskis Berbich explaining it to both coaches. 17 years, he says, he's been doing this.
Wow.
That's That's a lot of service.
It sure is. And, you know, he does the youth leagues also. He does the youth leagues. He's done the ILH. Spends a lot of time out here with our kids.
This is a 13-year club member.
Oh.
He is. All right, and we are back to play. Kali Maeda. Usui. Driving on Brand. Resentes. Brand playing some tough defense. They're going to call Bland with a block.
Offensive players by Iolani, they're just trying to draw some fouls.
They're trying to
get
some contact.
They really are. Yeah.
But that was only Punahou's 16 foul, so they're not in the bonus quite yet. Massaquel on the wing, down low to Sui. Up and under on Maeda. Maeda goes up and gets the rebound. Sadaraka. Turner Wong bringing it up for the buff and blue. Turnover. Massaquel to Maeda. And Iolani calls a timeout. Full timeout for the Raiders. Still a two-point game.
Interesting how this pressure defense is rattling the Punahou team. Not quite sure what they're looking for to get the ball down the court. They seem to be bringing it down the sideline when oftentimes it was working coming down the middle. So it'll be interesting to see what kind of adjustments they make, because it's taking them out of their offense right now.
I mean, and it's not as if either team's had a lot of success running their offense at this point. I mean, it's been not a lot of harmony to this game, let's say. Not a lot of rhythm. So,
right.
I mean, it's not like you're kind of expecting any one person to just kind of step up and, you know, as you said, you know, you expect Iolani to just kind of try and draw the foul and get to the line here, because, you know, there hasn't been any real rhythm.
Right.
Yet.
So your offense is your defense.
Right.
You make that work for you. You can score some points off of that transition.
Can help. All right. We're at 78 seconds here in the game, assuming there's no overtime, and we could very well see it. Of course, boys varsity game following this. Game time is supposed to be 6:30 p.m. Buff and Blue boys against the Damien Monarchs. And we're back to action. Kylie Maeda, ball for the Raiders. Jennifer Ching on the ball. Maeda looking frustrated. Looks like they might have had something in mind to run there.
Yes.
Maeda, gonna dish it back, kick it back out. Usui, Resentes. Punahou playing some real nice D here. Ching on the ball. That's a rough.
Wondering if that was a traveling call or a foul.
I think she may have tripped on her feet.
Yeah.
That's a personal foul on Turner Wong. Wasn't shooting, but that is Punahou's 17th foul, and Kali Maeda shooting a 1-1. It looked like she kind of tripped on her own feet there, at least from my angle. And that's no good, and Sadaraka comes down with a big rebound for the Buffalo Blue. We're under 40 seconds here. Punahou up by two. Let's see if Iolani tries the foul. They're in the bonus. See, Sadaraka is just going to, she looks for Wong. Near side to Jennifer Ching. Long pass, dangerous to Sadaraka. I think she's just waiting for Iolani to foul. And Maeda,
you really
Jennifer
play
Ching,
it.
They're just holding on to the ball. They're waiting for Iolani to foul them.
You don't want that foul. Gives it away, gives it right back to them after that shot. So they were able to hang on to that ball for a while, which killed some time on the clock, which was really helpful. So we're on the line with 2 points ahead, and that's going to help, but it still gives Iolani a chance to come back down the court.
Got to make both shots. Got to make both shots. You know, with That last play, Aubriana Johnson Edwards picked up her fourth personal foul. So both teams are in the bonus now. Neither team shooting two. Iolani with 18 fouls. Punahou with seven. But we need to make both, you know, you need to make the front end of this, or at least if we miss it, get the rebound.
Right.
Because, you know, once if it's a four-point game, it's a two-possession game, and I really, you know, I don't see Punahou's, I don't see Iolani scoring three baskets in the final 11 seconds.
Right. You want to burn some time off that clock. You put some pressure on there, but at the same time, you don't want to foul them and put them on the line. So they've got to be really careful in the backcourt defense.
So I imagine Coach Taylor's probably telling his team, you know, if they get possession on this, play some token defense. You know, we want them to run some clock. Don't let them, you know, do you see him maybe giving a foul away to keep him from shooting the three?
That puts him directly on the line. It could tie it.
Puts him on the line if the time gets down
right.
to.
But you could see Iolani just running the ball down, and that's
just,
what they're going to do.
Just go straight at the basket.
Somebody's going to get it, and they're going to run it down the court. They're either going to get fouled, they're going to get a layup, something's going to happen like that. But what we need to see are free throws being made.
Yes. We need Julia Brand to make her first and the one and one. And a lot of pressure off right now. At least now we know it's a three-point game, and they can only tie on their next possession. She drains this next basket. It's a two-possession game. Brand drains her second.
So you let him bring the ball down the court.
Maeda picks it up. Let's see if she goes straight to the basket. She's looking. They're looking for the three. Alex Massaquel, no good. Turner Wong comes down with the rebound. She's fouled. And I think you might be able to put a fork in this one, shall we?
I thought I saw some smiles on the court here.
I think they're smiling.
Yeah,
I think
feeling a little bit more comfortable right now.
Foul was called on Caitlin Shikata, her second. Punahou up by four. Wong at the line, shooting a one and one. Make it or miss it. This game's it's a two-possession game with 2 seconds left. And she misses the first. And that's the ball game. Your final score, Punahou Buff and Blue 46, Iolani Red Raiders 42. Punahou finally pulls ahead in the last minute and a half in what was a pretty tight contest, what became a tight contest in the second half, Shelley. So we'll have the Punahou, nice to see the Punahou girls rebound from their loss against That's a good question. Who do you think stood out for you for Punahou today? I mean, it was a real scrappy effort. Who would you look at for player of the game, maybe? Julia Brand, possibly? Yeah, and I think we're going to try to talk to Julia Brand after the game here, showing a lot of effort. Running the floor, playing some real tough defense on that final possession there for the Buff and Blue. So are we going to get, getting Julia Brand? Is that the
plan
here?
We're going to get her after shakes hands with everyone and gathers her things and our trusty. We probably should do a shout out to those people who have been helping us at the cameras and with the audio. Our director, Yuri Bershaw.
Yuri Bearsock.
Class of 87. Audio mixer, Evan Asado, class of 2011. Camera operators, Andrew Ryan, class of 2003. Courtney King, 2012. Cole Wright, 2012. Webcast producer, Kapena Chi, class of 2011. And floor producer, Brock Santee, 2014.
Got to thank the people that make it all possible.
That's right.
And here we have young Miss Brand.
All right, Julia, can you hear us?
Yeah.
All right.
Great.
How are you feeling right now?
Good. It was a tough game.
Tough game.
We pulled through, so it was
good. What was tough for you?
We just had a lot of up and down moments. We started off good, went down, but we did a good job of pulling it through all the way to the end. So that was really good. After our game last this 2 days ago against Mid-Pack. So it was nice to have a good win and and start, you know, building up from there again and keeping the momentum going.
Well, it seems like you guys definitely came out with a lot of fire in the first quarter after, you know, imagine you had a tough practice, you know, between the mid-pack game and today. But it seems like you guys definitely came up with a lot of fire and a lot of energy in the first quarter. And then it kind of tapered off. Was the Iolani pressure finally getting to you? I mean, were you finding it particularly stifling?
Well, we lacked communication in the, especially in the second quarter. I think that's when it caught up to us. And but we realized it, our coach talked to us about it, and we, you know, had our hands up, we were really alert, and were able to locate the shooters and keep them from scoring as much.
We were just talking about how your athleticism out there helps you in getting down the court, especially defensively when they're on a transition play and trying to get a layup off of that fast break. So how do you feel about that, being able to run down the guards and being able to stop their shots when you get down to the other side of the court? Is that something that comes pretty natural to you? I mean, is that instinctive?
Well, we're thinking, I mean, you're probably going to be one of the last people out there who's going to get winded. I mean, you're beating everybody else down the floor.
Well, I did cross country before this, so that helps. I get the endurance, and after this, I have track. But at practice, we've been doing a lot of 33s, which are, and if we miss our free throws, we gotta keep running. And I think part of that, you know, keeps us in shape and going up and down the court. So it's tough running, but it pays off.
Right, you're able to maintain that pace throughout the game. So we can see that in the rest of your team also, the rest of your teammates. How do you feel about that? We're talking about that offense and trying to get a flow in that in the first and the third and the fourth quarters, trying to find a little flow in your offense. Did you feel like there were some times in which you had a little trouble trying to get into a flow of your offense?
Our offense, well, I think in the beginning there's, we kind of bought into the pressure. It was a little tough, but, you know, I mean, picking up the dribble, we'd get trapped, but we kind of learned from our mistakes in the beginning and changed, you know, and kept it going, swung the ball around a lot, especially at the end.
Great answer, yeah. You guys did an awesome job coming back and finishing off.
So who do you have up next?
That's a good question.
That's a good question. We should probably know that, but... You know, I imagine, you know, you had that hard practice after the mid-pack loss, and, you know, you have to, I was talking to Coach Ching before the game, and it's, you know, the mid-pack game, and now here, you know, you guys always aren't going to be playing from ahead. So, you know, you need to learn how to play when the games are tight, too, now, right?
I think we play Kamehameha, I'm pretty sure.
Right. All right. Well, Julia, thank you very much for joining us this afternoon. I know you played a fantastic game today. And hope to see you again in the near future.
Congratulations on a great win.
All right, so we're going to wrap this up. My name's Mike Machado. I was very happy to be here today with Shelly Fay, and hope to see you again in the near future for one of these Quinnahoe Athletics webcasts. So until next time, aloha and ahui ho.
Thanks. It was great working with you, Mike. Ahui ho.